Welcome to the Gay Buddhist Forum, where teachers from all schools of Buddhism offer their perspectives on the Dharma and its application in modern times, especially for LGBTQI audiences. These talks are offered freely to the world and made possible by appreciative listeners. If you would like to support our efforts to share the Dharma with underserved audiences, please visit gaybuddhist.org. There you can donate, find a list of upcoming speakers, or enjoy many hundreds of these recorded talks dating back to 1996.
Good morning, everybody. Thanks again for joining us. There are 43 of us here this morning. It's a great group. So I'd like to introduce Larry. Larry's a member of the Occidental Laguna Sangha in Sebastopol, studying with Bruce Fortin in the lineage of Suzuki Roshi. He's an environmentalist and social justice activist and sits on the board of the Center for Climate Protection. He's also the former mayor of Sebastopol and the founder of Rumi's Caravan, which is dedicated to sharing the love of the oral tradition of poetry. So welcome, Larry, and let me know how I can assist technically during your talk. But thank you for being here. Welcome.
Thank you, David, and thank you all for inviting me to join you. It's wonderful to be here with you all again. This is such an incredible sangha that you have, and delight to see people calling in from other parts of the country and the world. So what I would like to speak about this morning is heart and soul, by which by heart I'm referring to the Heart Sutra, which actually has nothing to do with the human heart, but actually is called that because it goes to the heart of the teachings of Buddhism. But before I get into that, I'd like to share a short poem from another Zen practitioner, David Budbill, who says, Han Shan, that great and crazy Chinese poet 1,000 years ago, said, we're all like bugs in a bowl. I say, that's right. Every day, climbing up the sides, sliding back down over and over again. So sit in the bottom of the bowl, head in your hands, moan, cry, feel sorry for yourself. Or look around, greet your fellow bugs, say, hey, how are you doing? Say, nice bowl. So the nice bowl that David is talking about is the world of samsara, but it is also nirvana. And this is what the Heart Sutra in one page distills the essence of the teachings to, that samsara and nirvana are the same. There is no difference. And the way it's expressed in the Heart Sutra is form is emptiness, emptiness is form. And just a little word about what emptiness is. Emptiness doesn't mean nothingness. It doesn't mean, in fact, it really means everythingness. When the Heart Sutra speaks of emptiness, it's speaking of the absence of any self-existing, permanent, independent essence. And what that is essentially saying is that nothing exists on its own. Nothing exists without everything existing. That everything in the universe, everything in reality is expressed in everything else. And this is where we can find liberation and comfort and take refuge. And it says that there is no birth, there is no death, there is no beginning, there is no end. These are concepts, and concepts are obstacles to realization of the truth. And the practice of sitting, of meditation, is to move beyond obstacles, but it's not to attain anything. And this can be a hard one to understand, because we're not trying to achieve nirvana. The Heart Sutra says there is no attainment. And it doesn't mean that realization and enlightenment is impossible. What it means is that we are already in nirvana. Nirvana is not some future state, something that can be attained, something other than us, outside. But it is where we have always been. And our practice is about settling into what already is. And sometimes we try so hard, we struggle to achieve something, and that itself is an obstacle. I remember many, many years ago when I was working in a job that was just so soul-killing to me. I took a very short vacation for a week and went to Hawaii. And as soon as I checked into my hotel, I went out to the beach to do some body surfing. And there were beautiful waves. And I was trying to catch a wave, struggling and failing each time, until I absolutely exhausted myself. And then the wave caught me. And that was a profound, that was a moment of satori for me, of awakening, where I realized that I had been swimming so hard to catch the wave that the wave could not catch me. And sometimes I think we practice in this way, that we are so intent on our idea of what we want to attain and achieve in practice, that we don't let our natural ground of being, our bodhicitta, hold us. So sometimes just breathing and settling into what is all that we need to do. Emptiness means that there is no essential, unchanging, permanent us. When you think about it, and this is what our practice leads us to do, is to consider who we are. As Dogen says, to study the Buddha way is to study the self. To study the self is to forget the self. To forget the self is to be awakened into the myriad things of existence. And then everything is enlightened in that moment. So when we examine our own minds, we can never find anything that is permanently us, that is not connected to and dependent on everything else. Even our bodies, the material substance that makes up our bodies is constantly changing. Our spleen, every cell in our spleen is replaced every 24 hours. So we can't say that this is the same spleen I had last week. So the self is the same thing. So the Heart Sutra speaks about no self. And the idea of a permanent self that we have to defend is what gives rise to all of our suffering. Now, when I speak of soul, I want to be very clear. I'm not speaking in the Abrahamic tradition or the Hindu tradition, which holds that there is a permanent, indivisible soul. In Buddhism, we learn through practice that there is no permanent self. So when I speak of soul, I'm not talking about my soul or your soul, but the realm of soul, which by which I mean the interiority of everything, the insideness of everything. And when the Heart Sutra says form is emptiness, emptiness is form, it's speaking about the insideness. Form is the outsideness. When we look at something, we look at each other, or we look at a tree, or we look at our desk or a bed or an object outside, we see the outsideness of it. But our practice lets us experience the insideness of us. And soul is the insideness of everything. And when we can get a taste of our own interiority, of our own soul, then we see how absolutely interdependent and interconnected we are with everything else. The Bodhisattva vow says, Dharma gates are boundless. I vow to enter them. Well, one of the inescapable, unavoidable Dharma gates is that of grief and loss. And this is how most of us enter the world of soul. It's not through striving upward. It's not through achieving anything. In fact, it's just from the opposite, from our failures, from our loss, from our defeats. That drops us in, whether we ask for it or not, into the realm of soul. David White, in his poem, Well of Grief, says, those who will not slip beneath the still surface on the well of grief, turning down through its black waters to the place we cannot breathe, will never know the source from which we drink the secret water, cold and pure, nor find in the darkness glimmering the small round coins thrown by those who wish for something else. So even though we resist losing, we resist our grief, resist failure, when it happens, if we can allow it, we find that it actually is grace, that what we are losing are the hindrances to awakening. And what we're losing is the illusion of separateness, which is actually the definition of ego, the illusion, the delusion of separateness. And that is what causes our suffering. So another poem from Naomi Shihab Nye talks about this so beautifully. She says, before you can know the true meaning of kindness, you must lose things. feel the future dissolve in a moment like salt in a weakened broth. What you held in your hands, what you counted and carefully saved, all that must go so you know how great the desolate landscape can be between the regions of kindness. How you ride and ride, thinking the bus will never stop. The passengers eating maize and chicken will stare out the window forever. Before you can know the tender gravity of kindness, you must travel where the Indian in a white poncho lies dead by the side of the road. You must see how this could be you, how he too was someone who journeyed through the night with the plans and the simple breath that kept him alive. Before you can know kindness as the deepest thing inside, you must know sorrow as the other deepest thing. You must wake up to sorrow. You must speak with it until your tongue grips the thread of all sorrow and you see the full size of the claw. Then you know it is only kindness that means anything anymore. Only kindness that wakes you in the morning and ties your shoes and sends you out to purchase bread and mail letters. Only kindness that lifts its head from the crowd of the world to say, it is I you have been looking for all your life, and then goes with you everywhere like a shadow or a friend. So when you touch the thread of your sorrow, it connects you to the sorrow of the world. And this is where compassion lives. So I think it's accurate to say that suffering is compassion, because suffering cannot exist without compassion, and compassion cannot exist without suffering. And I think we can also say that no self, anatta, is nirvana, is everything. Because when we enter that Dharma gate of soul, we find that we are held tenderly and lovingly and intimately by the entire universe. Our idea of separate self is like a wave in the ocean. We're afraid to dissolve back into the ocean, but the wave arises and falls. This is the way it has always been. We are just waves of bodhicitta moving through existence. And when we can let that wave catch us and hold us, then there is no more fear, because there's nothing to lose, nothing to defend, nothing to protect. We've always been held safely. We have always been in nirvana. Another poem that I'd like to share. Well, let me back up just a sec. And address where we are as a nation. I think as a people, we are experiencing profound loss and grief, and we are doing our damnedest to stay out of feeling it. And as a result, we're doing great harm to ourselves and to each other. But inevitably, we are being brought down into the realm of soul. And this will be our salvation. Our loss will be our salvation. And in negotiating this passage, it is so important that people like you who are doing the practice can hold your hearts open with compassion for the suffering of all and maintain some equanimity in the midst of all the changes and understand that impermanence and change are the nature of reality, that there are no permanent feelings, no permanent ideas, no permanent anything. All is flow, all is change. And in holding that equanimity, you are the hands of the Bodhisattva. You are the hands of Avalokiteshvara, of Kuan Yin, the thousand hands, the thousand eyes, the thousand ears to hear the suffering of the world. And this is the medicine that the world needs. So I think I'd like to end with another poem from Jennifer Wellwood called The Dakini Speaks, and then we can open it up for a conversation or questions or whatever you'd like. She says, "Friends, let's grow up. Let's stop pretending we don't know the deal here. And if we truly haven't noticed, let's wake up and notice. Look, everything we know will be lost. It's simple. How could we have missed it for so long? Let's grieve our losses fully, like human, ripe beings. But let's not be so disappointed by them. Let's not be so shocked. Let's not act so betrayed as though life had broken her secret promise to us. Life's only promise is impermanence, and she keeps it with ruthless impeccability. To a child, she seems cruel, but she is only wild, and her compassion exquisitely precise, brilliantly penetrating, luminous with truth. She strips away the unreal to show us the real. This is the true ride. Let's give ourselves to it. Let's stop making deals for a safe passage. There isn't one anyway, and the cost is too high. We are not children anymore. The true human adult gives everything for what cannot be lost. Let's dance the wild dance of no hope." Thank you. So I invite questions, thoughts, comments.
Thank you very much for your presentation.
You're very welcome.
I really like the last part that you were saying. Don't be devastated. Don't be shocked. Don't be brokenhearted. Don't be angry and resentful, actually. And I was reading a note by Thich Nhat Hanh who said, he says everything I need for enlightenment is already here. something along those lines. I don't have it in front of me. One of the wonderful experiences that I get to have in this particular life is that I was raised in poverty in the United States of America. And there was a time when there was 8 to 14 people living in a two-bedroom house. That's the environment I grew up in America. I grew up in poverty. I do have somewhat of a burden because I am very middle class at this point. And every day I recognize my responsibility to the environment and the world that I grew up in. I also entered into the gay world, the homosexual gay world in the 70s. And both my growing up and that entering taught me very clearly and very well that I was not white and that I was, in fact, a third class citizen. And that has been the one consistent thing about being in America that I've had to deal with since I've been here. And particularly being in the gay world was really challenging because to be a triple minority is really hard. So anatta, no self, no coming, no going, no after, no before. I hold you close to me. I release you to be free because I am in you and you are in me. That's Thich Nhat Hanh. It just came out. Every aspect of the society I live in is structured in such a way that it is divided. It is segregated. Black people live in one part and people live in another part. I work in the Oakland Unified School District, which is one of the diverse districts in the country, and certainly in California. And there are white schools and there are black schools. I work in a black school. So this idea of the interconnectedness, the words don't come to me, but this idea of this profundity, nothing exists independent of anything else. You know, I like the idea, James Brown said, I got soul and I super bad, you know? And so when black people talk about soul, we talk about this really deep sense of something, love, understanding, appreciation, you know, liberation. So I'll conclude by saying this. I'm confused about how I can live in such a hierarchically structured society. I'm part of a caste. And the Dawits let Martin Luther King know when he came to visit, you are part of a caste system. And Martin Luther King was like, no, I'm not. When he came home, he realized, yes, I am. You know, the 1916 project really pointed out last year, yeah, of the 400 years of African-American people living in this country under this tyranny. And the tyranny is unfolding in the most ugly way right now, you know, because it is the epitome of white supremacy. And if me and my people and my cohorts and my allies are not working on that, that's like in AIDS, we said, you know, silence equals death. So thank you for your presentation. I will listen to it again.
Thank you. Asa, thank you so much for those beautiful, profound, heartfelt words. I could not agree with you more about the challenge that we face. And white supremacy is not, racism is not a black problem. It's a white problem. And it is what has poisoned our culture from the beginning. And, you know, archetypally speaking, one of the functions of the trickster archetype, and the con man is one aspect of the trickster, one profound function of the trickster archetype is to reveal the shadow. So we have been living under the domination of a con man for the last 4 years, and America's shadow is now revealed so clearly that we cannot ever ignore it again. So it's here for us to deal with. And that is a gift to us, because this is the time. So thank you so much, Asa, for bringing that up. And yes, we live in a caste system. And even those of us in the middle class who are white and male and privileged suffer from a caste system. Thank you.
I really appreciate what you just said, Larry, and the threads in your talk really resonated with something that's I've been spending a lot of time thinking about the past couple of years, really, is that like the touching our own suffering is just like the only way out. And it's like that first noble truth, as opposed to like, oh yeah, be like out there is awful or whatever. Like I'm born into this terrible world that's all out there. And through my practice over the years, just taking a, you know, learning over time that there is a path or part of the path is like, that really kind of scary, you know, archaeological dig of like, how do I experience suffering and what that can open up when it starts, when I, you know, when I allow myself to start touching that. One of my teachers shared with me something really powerful. He was talking about, you know, sharing with me about like Shen Rezig of Avalokiteshvara and how like we wear our shirts and like, and we just don't feel any pain. You know what I mean? It's okay. But like, you know, when you're sick, like the lightest touch of your skin hurts. Yeah. And he was just, he was, how do we understand about, or the Bodhisattva even, or Shen Rezig's, capacity to see suffering is so sensitive, like so sensitized that just slightest touch is, and, but we don't think of it as suffering, but if we really open ourselves up to, we realize that it, you know, it is. Asa sharing is like, as a white man, you know, really just like kind of an eye opener for me the past year, maybe year and a half. And I'm still like, how do I begin to do this, is to really touch in deep about what's been at stake for me as a white man living in a racialized world and like under white supremacy and like the suffering it causes me, and how until I can really identify that, like, or like that process, then I can finally like move forward, you know what I mean? And with action, really, you know, to live in the world and not like repeat it, not feed into it. But it's like really is requiring me to understand deeply my how I suffer too, you know? And like you said, it's a white person problem in that way. I mean, that's spiritual and it's also very pragmatic in the world in which we're living in America right now. So it's like the two of you sharing like really helps like bringing those together. So thank you. Yeah.
Thank you for that, David. And what I would like to add is that any suffering is my suffering. The idea that that suffering belongs to somebody else other than me is part of, that's part of the delusion, the one of the hindrances to awakening. And when we turn towards suffering rather than away from it, then we turn towards the truth. And then suffering becomes compassion, and compassion is release, and compassion is nirvana.
I just wanted to say something. I appreciated the talk, although I admit I'm kind of steeped in a Western kind of philosophy and as somebody said, the Abrahamic tradition. But you know, the Latin root for compassion is to suffer with. And I think that's a profound understanding of what suffering, true suffering, entails. I've been reading a lot during this time about World War II, the Second World War. My father was in the war. We're watching a series now about what happened when it was about a French village during the course of the German occupation of France, and what happened in that village, and you know, people turning against each other and turning each other in, and you know, Jews being arrested and deported, and I've been doing some other reading, and including about a brilliant gay consul who was posted to Berlin between 1929 and 1939, and saw what was happening, and saw the Nazis for who they were. I think it's hard for us living in this time, even with this incredibly confusing and infuriating period that we're in, to fully comprehend the suffering that people in that time, in that era, whatever theater of war, whether it would be Europe or East Asia, the Japanese militarists, went through, I think. But it's important, I think, this is something that came from my own religious training as a Roman Catholic, is not to look away. There was a group in France who helped, were very anti-Nazi and helped protect people and hide people. It was called témoignage, which means witness. And I think that part of our, at least for me, part of what we are, if you will, called to do is witness all of this, and not in silence. I mean, depending on the context. So, you know, but I do think that we can draw on lessons from the past, I guess I'm saying, and including the healing that can come, I think, from this witness or this suffering with other people. Thank you, Larry.
Oh, Mike, that was beautifully said. I think bearing witness is maybe one of the most important tasks for us at this time. You know, we are in the midst of the greatest spasm of a species extinction in 60 million years. Our whole planetary ecosystem is going down. We may be able to turn that around, and I hope we will. But in any event, we need to bear witness to what we are losing. And we need to bear witness to the suffering of people around us and animals around us. I think we are called morally to do whatever we can to ease the suffering of the world. And if our actions cannot directly reduce that suffering, we can and must bear witness to it. I think that's the bottom line. Thank you for raising that.
Larry, I really appreciate your talk so much, and you know, it's such an interesting concept of trying to appreciate the bowl that we're in with all our other bugs, and appreciate all the other bugs, and appreciate the suffering that all the bugs are having there. You know, I think there is some suffering, there's a lot of suffering that is very, very easy to identify with. It is so clear and so obvious and so heart-wrenching. And yet, I think, you know, one of the premises is that we are all suffering. And there are, you know, if you will, the perpetrators of that are causing suffering in some people. It's more difficult to be compassionate with them. Verging on impossible, but maybe not, I don't know. And it's so challenging to think how we can express, how we can be witness to our compassion for those people. You know, how we can express our care, express our witness. And many of them have no interest. And many people who are suffering don't have an interest really in, don't have a conscious interest in having people being compassionate because they're so involved in the suffering itself. So, I don't know if you have any thoughts about that. It's such a big challenge, I think, for me now. But I really do appreciate so much what you've said, and I don't know if there's a way that you'll share the poetry that you shared also. But
I will send copies to Jerry, and he can share them with you. Would that work? Okay, I will do that. Thank you, Donald. That is a tough one. How to hold compassion for those who have no compassion for you. Compassion does not mean allowing someone to do you harm. It does not mean condoning the actions that people take out of their own pain and suffering. Sometimes preventing their actions is the most compassionate thing you can do. Getting a white supremacist out of the White House is maybe the most compassionate thing we can do for the country and for him. We can wish them freedom from suffering, and how I hold it. And when I do my loving kindness practice, my metta practice, I usually include people like the one whose name I won't speak because it, so, anyway, because I wish them freedom from suffering, because I know that if they are not suffering, they will not be doing damage. So the exercise of loving kindness for them is a way, it's like lifting weights. It strengthens my own compassion muscles. And it's so hard. Yeah, you start with yourself and your loved ones and your friends and your community, but you can move it out farther and farther. Even if you don't actually find the ability to wish them happiness, you can wish them happiness, to wish to be able to wish them happiness. That's a practice. A poem that comes to me. How much time have we got, David?
Well, we're just about there. Oh. Yeah, we want to start wrapping things up.
Well, then I won't leave. Well, let me leave you with this poem then.
Please, please.
Yeah. This is one of mine. It's called Rise and Fall. Let go of fear and rest in that which is. For peace, like love, comes to those who allow it. Let go of fear and rest in the stillness. Watch the breath rise and fall. Watch the tides rise and fall. Watch statues rise and fall. Watch towers rise and fall. Watch walls rise and fall. Watch empires rise and fall. Watch the breath rise and fall. Let go of fear and rest in the arms of the one who has always held you, the one who holds oceans and atoms and empires and stars. Let go of fear and watch what happens next. So thank you all for your kind attention. I will send those poems to Jerry and he can pass them on to you. And may we all be safe and free from fear. May we be filled with kindness and generosity. May we be free from suffering and from the causes of suffering. May we live in peace. May we all live in peace, all beings.
Thank you, Larry. Thanks for joining us today. Really enriching conversation and sharing. I want to give gratitude to Matthew and Jerry and Jeff, for those who are really volunteer and keep the coordination going through the communications, the coordinating of the speakers every week, and the board for making this all happen. And it doesn't happen by itself. We want to invite people to support GBF by offering Donna in a way that's meaningful for you. You can do it by check or online. I just posted the link for people. It covers monthly expenses, Donna, for our teachers. And we continue to give a little to the San Francisco Buddhist Center, our physical, the folks that offer us space prior to the pandemic. Certainly their expenses haven't disappeared. So please consider supporting today. And then thank you, Jerry Posted, who the speaker for next week. You can always go to the gaybuddhist.org or our Facebook to see the list of the teachers coming up. Wednesday evening, there's also a meditation group, the Silent Sit, followed by group discussion. Everyone's welcome to that. And I wanted to ask if there's any other announcements, things coming up that people want to share with the community. Okay. Well, thank you again, Larry. Can do a quick continued dedication of merit to close things out. So for any merit that's been accumulated today by us coming together in our practice, may it be sent out for the benefit of all beings. May all beings have happiness and the causes of happiness. May all beings be free from suffering and the causes of suffering. May all beings never be without the supreme bliss, which is free from all suffering. And may all live in the great equanimity, which is free from all attachment and aversion, believing in the equality that all that lives.
Thanks, Larry. Thank you, Dave.
Wishing you all a good week. Thank you.
Thank you for listening to the Gay Buddhist Forum. If you would like to hear several new talks per month, and be notified of upcoming speakers so you can participate live. Please subscribe to this podcast, like us on Facebook, and join our mailing list by visiting gaybuddhist.org.